One Day in April, a Hillsborough story, a mother's journey through love, loss, and her fight for justice. Written by Jenni Hicks and read by Jenni Hicks and Sue Johnston. This book has been written by me in everlasting memory of my beautiful daughters, Sarah Louise and Victoria Jane Hicks. You are my shining lights on the path to truth and justice. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Martin Luther King, Jr. Dear reader, on the morning of the 15th of April, 1989, my husband Trevor and I, and our daughters Sarah and Vicki, set off to watch Liverpool FC play in the FA Cup semi-final at the Hillsborough Football Stadium in Sheffield. That night, Trevor and I drove back alone. Our two daughters were left in body bags on a dirty gymnasium floor at the football ground. Within hours, we, an ordinary family, were headline news. What followed were years of lies, cover-up and deceit, loss, grief, breakup, and divorce. This is the story of how I have attempted to cope with it all.
Chapter 1. It was a lovely spring day in April when the flowers finally came into bloom. A mass of red and yellow tulips that matched the latest Liverpool Football Club's strip. We lived in London, but my daughters Sarah, 19, and Vicky, 15, were avid Liverpool supporters. That previous autumn, they had planted dozens of bulbs alternately, one red, one yellow, and so on, all the way round the borders of the lawn and down the steps to the house, which now looked amazing. It was coming towards the end of the Easter holidays when Vicky was due back at school and my husband Trevor would be driving Sarah back to Liverpool to begin her third term at university before going on to his flat in Dudley to start the working week in nearby King's Winford. But there was one big event the girls were really looking forward to before then, just as I was. On the last Saturday of the holidays, 15th of April 1989, Liverpool were playing Nottingham Forest in the semi-final of the FA Cup at Hillsborough Football Stadium, Sheffield, and were going to travel up to Sheffield to watch Liverpool win. Sarah was tall, elegant and beautiful, with big blue eyes, blonde hair and striking features, and my friend Chris would often say, she resembled Princess Di. Sarah had style and class and looked good in whatever she chose to wear. Kind and generous and always helpful to others, she didn't have a competitive bone in her body. Well, except when it came to watching Liverpool FC play, and was as beautiful on the inside as she was outside. She was also intellectually very bright and was given the opportunity to go to Oxford and was offered a scholarship at Imperial College London to read chemistry, but she'd had other ideas. Towards the end of the Easter holidays, Sarah had asked me to help lighten her hair where her dark roots were coming through. Then she'd permed mine into an 80s wiggly style in preparation for my return to work in the Earth Sciences department of our local sixth form college on the Monday after the match. Vicky, who was 3 years younger than her big sister, was a few inches shorter and had the biggest cornflower blue eyes you'd ever seen. She also had beautiful long dark hair and a fashion style very different to Sarah's. Vicky could melt anyone's heart with just a look. She was funny without even realising it. She could always manage to make people smile. When she was little, strangers in the street would come up to her and pat her on the head and comment on how cute she was. Vicky liked to put on a strong exterior. She was ambitious and liked nice things. But inside, she was a sensitive soul with a heart of gold. And, like Sarah, she couldn't bear social injustice. During the Easter holiday, I would hear Vicki playing her music upstairs. If Sarah was in her room at the time, she would put her music on too. The next thing I knew, Vicki would turn hers up, and then Sarah, until you two and Frankie Goes to Hollywood were blaring out from their rooms on the landing as the girls tried to outdo each other. "I'm trying to study here. Tell her, Mum." Vicki, in her aha t-shirt and baggy jeans, yelled down the stairs. She had been working hard most days over the Easter period in preparation for her GCSEs that she was taking at her school in Elstree, but this wasn't one of those days. She'd spent all afternoon going through her reel-to-reel tapes from the charts and playing them back while setting out all her earrings in neat rows on the dressing table. "Turn that music down, the pair of you," I yelled up the stairs. It was just as well we lived in a large detached house where we couldn't bother the neighbours, as there was a lot of door slamming between the music and the shouting. But I knew it would be all right later because, for all their arguments and getting on each other's nerves, the girls were fiercely loyal and always, always had each other's back. And that would be the case until their very last breath. The day before the much-anticipated semi-final at Hillsborough, Sarah had spent the morning packing in preparation for going back to uni the day after the match. It was a gorgeous, warm, sunny day for the time of year, and so in the afternoon, Sarah and Vicki opted to sunbathe in the back garden. They wanted a tan. The three of us were having such a lovely, relaxing day that although I was supposed to be doing the weekly shop, I decided not to bother. In any case, I was due back at work at Stanmore Sixth Form College the following week, so I thought I'd just enjoy the day too. As we sat out in the sun, Vicki suddenly announced that her eyebrows needed plucking. Typical Vicki. She wanted her eyebrows to look good for the semi-final. So I drove her to a beautician's in Hatch End. Strangely, although Trevor would usually arrive home late every Friday night, on this occasion he came home early. Vicki and I had just got back from the beautician's when she said, "I really fancy a cornetto." So she and Trevor went to Waitrose to get the ice creams and a few bits of shopping for dinner as well. When they got back, Vicki produced a box of mint cornettos from the shopping bag and I said to her, "Let's have the proper food first and then you can have the cornettos." But after the meal, no one was hungry, so we said we would have the ice creams on Saturday night when we got back from the Hillsborough match. I made a picnic lunch for us for the next day, as usual, and we all went to bed. I didn't realise that this would turn out to be our final day together. The following morning, we got up early to set off for our family day out. There was a lot of excitement because it was the semi-final, but Vicki typically couldn't decide which T-shirt to wear with her jeans. I called up the stairs a couple of times. "Vicki, we're ready to go." Sarah and I were waiting downstairs and Trevor was in the car, getting more and more impatient. She finally emerged in a white T-shirt with a large motif on the front, long navy grandad cardigan, baggy jeans and brown boots tied with green laces. Then, putting in her favourite earrings, she shrugged. "What's all the fuss about?" And we set off for the game. Chapter 2. I'm proud to say that Liverpool is now my adopted home and where I have lived for over 30 years. It's where my heart is and the place where I can still be close to my girls. But I was actually born in County Durham and brought up a few miles away over the border in Yarm, North Yorkshire. Although I had a very happy childhood, as an adult I came to realise that my early life was not like other people's, and To this day, it's still something of a mystery to me. However, I believe my childhood and the differences that set me apart helped me to develop the resilience and strength I would need many years later to survive the loss of my children and to fight for justice for them, a struggle that would go on for over 30 years. I was just 6 months old when my mum, Rose Pete, took me to a bus stop in Stockton-on-Tees and gave me away. Of course, I was only a baby, so I have no memory of what happened that day, but I'm told she handed me over to Mrs. Broadley, the policeman's wife, who was standing in the queue. She lived next door to my paternal grandmother in Yarm, 4.5 miles away. My mum and dad continued living in Stockton and having more children. But for the next 11 years of my life, I would be brought up by my grandparents, Helen and Jack Pete, who were already in their 70s at that point. My dad's siblings, Tommy, Stan, Lizzie, and her teenage son Lawrence, or Lol, as we called him, also lived there. And with Dad's other brother, Uncle Alfie, living across the road with his wife and twin sons, I had family all round me. My new home with Granny Pete was a 3-bedroom 1940s-built council house in Coronation Crescent, Yarm, a semi-rural location with fields at the back. With 7 of us living there, it was always a busy house, and whenever Granny had visitors, they would be ushered into the front room. Granny brought chair backs for the sofa and armchairs to stop Lol and my uncles getting grease on them from the brill cream they used to slick back their short back and sides. When I stop and reflect, I can still hear the ticking of the clock on the mantelpiece and see the grinning Toby jugs either side of it. Above the fireplace was a mirror where Auntie Lizzie, with her large hazel eyes and thick auburn hair, would slap on her Pond's face cream. Auntie was naturally pretty and didn't wear makeup. The front room walls were covered with photographs of relatives long gone before I'd arrived. Beside the dining table was a china cabinet where the best tea service was kept and only brought out for Christmas, weddings and funerals and other special occasions. Granny wasn't house proud, but if it had been raining, she'd insist my uncles and cousin, who lived with us, took off their work boots each evening and left them by the back door. That's as far as it went, though. Despite not having much, it was a comfortable home. At the time, we were the only family in our street to boast a television set. I'm not sure how Granny afforded it, but it was her pride and joy. As a child, she'd tell me how she invited the entire street round to watch the Queen's coronation. Auntie Lizzie, who had previously been in service to a family in an affluent area of Manchester, helped Gran with the household chores every week. On Wednesdays, she'd put down some old newspaper, then polish the stair rods with brasso until you could see your face in them, while Grandma shone the horse brasses around the fireplace. At mealtimes, we would all get together as a family, sitting around the big table in the back kitchen, as it was called, while Granny got our dinner ready. Her staples were things like steak and kidney pudding and stew and dumplings. Amazing smells always came from the kitchen. Gran was such a great cook. But fridge freezers were not available to ordinary folk then, so she had to store everything in the walk-in pantry. This included the rabbits my Uncle Alfie, a gamekeeper, would bring us, and which Granny would keep on a shelf until she was ready to make a pie or stew with them. Seeing those poor lifeless creatures lying there would make me feel sad, but I still enjoyed the dishes Grandma made with them. Uncle Stan was the youngest of Dad's brothers and Gran's favourite of her 4 sons, which meant that any second helpings that were going, he'd always get them. though being the baby of the family, I didn't do so badly myself. My cousin Lol was the next one to me in age, but he was in his late teens when I arrived there. I remember getting into bed one night and letting out a scream when something prickly touched my leg, only to see Lol doubled up with laughter on the landing. "Gotcha," he said, as I found the scrubbing bush that he'd hidden in there. Lol, who was good-looking, well-dressed and very popular with the girls, was always joking around. Grandad and my uncles all wore cloth caps, and looking back now, I realise we were a true working-class family. We worked to live. Indeed, the biggest fear in our house was not having a job, so to earn a bit extra, my uncles would work for the local farmers on their days off, particularly during harvest time. We had a big garden where we grew our own vegetables, and an allotment where my uncles kept pigs, ducks, geese, and hens for eggs. There were apple trees and pear trees too. My uncles and I would go out mushrooming, and in the early autumn we'd pick blackberries from the hedgerows to make jam and puddings with. It was a country childhood, and we saved a lot of money by being self-sufficient. Our biggest, most prized modcon was an inside bathroom and a toilet. Few houses boasted such a luxury at the time, but we only had a coal fireplace in the front room. On winter nights it would get so cold, icicles would form inside the windows. So Granny made sure no one went to bed without two hot water bottles each. How I loved the comforting smell of those rubbery hot water bottles, one of which I would hug to me while the other went on my feet. The coal was delivered each week by the coalman. "Watch those sacks now, our Jennifer," Granny would call to me as I stood on the back step and counted the sacks emptied into the coal house. Granny had no intention of paying for more than the coal man delivered. Looking back, I learnt a lot from my granny, but one of the lessons that stuck with me most is that you always have to watch out for yourself, and if anyone tries to take advantage of you, you must be prepared to fight your corner. We may have been poor, but I had a charmed existence growing up with my extended family in North Yorkshire. Yarm is a beautiful tree-lined little town with a cobbled high street and Georgian houses either side. Perhaps the horseshoe-shaped River Tees running around the town brought me luck, as I loved my life there. The bridge, which crosses the river, still forms the border between North Yorkshire and County Durham, which Mrs. Broadley and I would have crossed on the bus on the day when Mum, who was pregnant with my brother by then, sent me to Granny. Everyone knew everyone else, and I felt safe there. My Uncle Alfie's twin sons were only a few months younger than me, so I had two ready-made playmates in the street. I used to love being in my cousin's cricket team, playing out in the summer and using an old orange box for a wicket. My daughter Sarah would take after me. She loved games too and was a tomboy, just like me when she was younger. As I grew up, I became close to Mrs. Broadley, who was as wide as her name suggests, and her policeman husband Bert, who was rarely out of uniform. As a child, he was how I saw policemen, and I realised what an important job he had. He was somebody everyone respected. The Broadleys would always make a big fuss of me. "Come round any time, Jennifer," Mrs. Broadley would say, and she'd make a chocolate cake especially for me. Their house was posh inside compared to ours. They had a sofa with plump cushions on it and a fitted carpet that went right up to the edge of the walls. Not cold lino everywhere like ours. There were shelves all the way along one of the walls, full of wonderful books and encyclopedias, which I'd take out and gaze at for hours. We really only had local newspapers in our house for the sport. Books, like the Broadleys had, would become so important to me later on, particularly legal ones, when I began looking for justice for my girls. Although ours was a matriarchal family with Granny in charge, Grandad would keep my uncles and Lol in line, even when they were strapping men. Grandad didn't have to say a word. One look from him was enough. They never answered him back or swore in front of him or Granny the way they did when they were out. My grandparents, like most parents in the neighbourhood, sent all their children to Sunday school. I started when I was 6 years old. On Sunday lunchtimes at 12 o'clock, Uncle Tommy and Uncle Stan would go to the local pub and stay there until 2 o'clock, when Granny and Auntie Lizzie would have the Sunday roast dinner on the table. After dinner, they always fell asleep in the two big armchairs in the living room. Then at 3 o'clock, dressed in my best clothes, I would go to Sunday school at the Wesleyan Chapel with the other local children. Unlike some of the children who attended, I relished going each week and loved hearing the stories about Jesus and parables like the Good Samaritan. The message I learnt there was this: if you were good, Jesus wouldn't let anything bad happen to you. And I found that very comforting as a six-year-old. I also liked ringing the little bells on the wooden rack. Problem was, you were only allowed to ring them when it was your birthday, whereas I would go up to ring them regularly until the teacher noticed and I was told off. Although there are huge parts of my early life that I don't remember, I do remember ringing those bells. It was the kind of cheeky thing my Vicki would get up to when she was little. As soon as Sunday school ended, it would be time to go home for tea and to see my dad, who came to visit me at Granny's every Sunday. Granny always laid on a big tea then, when all the family were expected to attend in their best clothes. My dad would put on his suit, even though he looked stiff and uncomfortable in it. Granny would make tin salmon sandwiches, followed by what I'd now call a deconstructed trifle, which was a bowl of jelly, another of custard, one of tinned fruit, and another of cream, that Granny did especially for my dad, who liked all those things separately, but insisted he didn't like trifle. Every Sunday, Dad would bring one of my younger siblings with him to visit. My brother John was born a year after me, and Mum and Dad then had another two sons, Barry and the baby of the family, David. So they'd all get a turn coming to their Granny Pete's every 3 weeks. But I never expected my mum to come over, as I knew by now that she wouldn't. She never came to Yarm, and my granny never went to my parents' house. No one in our house ever spoke badly about Mum. They all liked her, so I have no idea why she never came. But I would still see my parents regularly and remain close to my dad, Chris. In my mind, I was just a normal, happy kid with what was to me a normal childhood, growing up in a house full of kind, caring people. I knew I was loved by my grandparents, and I never doubted I was loved by my parents too, even though my mum was more like an auntie to me. When I was 9 or 10, I went most evenings to ballet and tap at Connie Hall's School of Dancing in Stockton. Every Wednesday evening, Aunt Lizzie would take me to visit my mum and dad's afterwards. Their house was a dark, two up, two down, in a street of identical crumbling Victorian terraces. Even at the tender age I was then, it wasn't difficult to see my parents were struggling and poorer even than us. They didn't even have a bathroom. My dad and brothers had to get washed at the kitchen sink, and on a Friday night, my mum would bring in the tin bath that was kept outside on a peg in the yard. Mum had to heat up water in the copper boiler to fill it, and then the family would take turns to use it. It was a Friday night ritual at their house, which made me glad we had a proper bath at home with hot water coming out of the taps and a house surrounded by countryside. There was always a strange, musty smell about my parents' house too, which would make me feel nauseous. I later realised it was the smell of damp. All the houses in the road were condemned, with families on the council list waiting to be rehoused. So Mum always kept a big roaring open fire going in the living room to try to keep the damp at bay. But if we went on Saturday afternoons, there was a real weekend treat. My mum would go to the Sparks bakery and buy a box of 6 cream cakes for the whole family, and I would get the pick of the cakes because everyone else would have theirs for Sunday tea. There was always a good selection, strawberry tarts, chocolate eclairs, meringues filled with cream. It was like looking into a jewellery box. Granny always frowned on bought cakes. She insisted everything had to be homemade. Although I was always pleased to see my parents, it never occurred to me to ask to stay, and by the end of the evening I was ready to go back to my granny and to the home I was used to. My dad would walk me and Auntie Lizzie to the same bus stop where my mum had handed me over all those years ago, but I wasn't aware of that then. Instead, I was more interested in the fish and chip shop alongside it. "Ooh, they smell nice," I used to say, and Dad would disappear into the shop, returning with a bag of chips for me to eat on the bus on the way home. When I think back, I have nothing but pride and admiration for my dad, who worked his fingers to the bone to make enough money to feed his growing family, and admiration for my mum too, who brought up 3 strong boys in what were undeniably tough conditions. When I became a parent myself, I wanted my girls to have many of the things that my family and I didn't have. But I also wanted to bring them up to be independent, fair-minded, and resilient to whatever life threw at them when they went out into the world, as I'd learnt to be. But most of all, kind and loved. I know I succeeded. Looking back, football was one of the defining experiences of my childhood. When I'd come home from seeing my mum on a Wednesday evening, the midweek match would be on the radio, and my uncles would be poring over the sports section of the papers, working out the score draws to put on their football coupons that might win them a fortune at the weekend. Then on Saturdays it was football crazy at our house, with the TV on and heated discussions about the teams and how our local team, Middlesbrough, or Borough, were doing. At 4:45, my uncles would all huddle round the radio in the back kitchen, waiting for James Alexander Gordon to read out the scores while they checked the results against their coupon copies. "We're going to make our fortune today," Uncle Tommy would say to me as he rubbed his hands in anticipation, only to chuck the coupon away in disgust after the results came in. Everyone would be moaning then. If only they'd put this score and not that and gone with their instinct or some such. It was a family ritual. On occasion, my uncles would take me to Borough's home matches at Ayrson Park. They'd take me as a special treat, as, with a child in tow, they couldn't go to a pub afterwards for the usual match post-mortem. I was small, even as a child, and when we arrived at the game, they'd shout, "Watch out, child coming over," then hand me over the heads of the other Borough supporters and sit me on the high barriers where I could get a bird's eye view of the game. I especially loved the Wednesday night games when my uncles and I would travel to the ground on the football specials, which were double-decker buses laid on to take supporters to a match. With all the camaraderie and banter between the fans on those double-decker buses, it built up the excitement before the game. When we'd get there, I loved seeing the pitch and the players all lit up by the floodlights. And even though Borough was struggling near the bottom of Division 2 and often lost at the time, that didn't matter to me as the atmosphere was electric when the team came on. Although I was small, I remember so clearly when Borough's new signing, a young player called Brian Clough, made his first appearance in the club's shirt on the home ground. The fans began to go wild as he knocked in goal after goal in his first few games alone, and he steadily and single-handedly improved the club's position over the next few years. Though Borough never went up to the first division, Clough was a brilliant player, and while he naturally moved on after he made his name at Borough, he made a lasting impression. How different these feelings towards him were in comparison to the next time I would see him, when he was manager of Nottingham Forest and we were on opposing sides in the fateful FA Cup semi-final at Hillsborough. The comments he would make about the Liverpool fans after that semi-final carried weight because he'd been there that day. Seeing footage of him now and hearing his opinions, sadly, makes me feel sick to the pit of my stomach. Chapter 3. I loved going to our local school. I enjoyed every minute of it and made lots of friends there. Because I was so tiny for my age, our infant teacher, Miss Mackie, would make me climb a stepladder in my net tutu and wings to be the fairy on top of the tree in the Christmas show. It made Granny and Auntie laugh when they came to see me. It's strange to think that my lack of height, along with my girl's insistence that I take the seated ticket for the game, would years later play a vital role in my surviving the Hillsborough disaster. I passed my 11 plus and was offered a place at the local grammar school, but my granny and uncles thought it would be too expensive and wasted on a girl whose only job was to get married and have babies. My family weren't being unkind. Working class children were expected to go out to work as soon as they could to contribute to the family income. I wasn't disappointed. I was pleased to be staying on in the senior part of the local school that I was already attending. I was 9 years old when I first experienced loss. Auntie Lizzie had taken me to a dancing competition in South Shields in the Easter holidays, where dance schools from all over the North East came to compete. First prize was a gold medal and a silver cup. We left home early that Saturday morning to make sure I got there on time. Auntie was really proud of my success, and on the way back she made sure everyone on the coach home got sight of the gold medal and silver cup I'd won. It was such a happy journey back, and I was bursting to tell Granny I'd won and show her the silver cup. But as soon as we got off the coach in our road, we saw all the curtains were drawn at our house, even though it was still daylight. In those days, closed curtains meant only one thing. Someone had died. Granny was crying when we went into the house, and my uncles were upset. Granddad had suddenly passed away. I couldn't mention my success or show Granny my trophies because it wasn't the time for it, and it never would be. Granny went into mourning, and from that day onwards, there was something about her that was lost, never to return. Less than 2 years later, she passed away too. We were all devastated. Granny had been the centre of our home, and she had been both my grandmother and my mum. Despite how I felt, I didn't cry. I felt numb. I'd been brought up to get on with whatever life threw at you, and that's what I tried to do. Granny was buried with my granddad at Yarm Cemetery. As her coffin was lowered into the ground, my twin cousins and I each threw a red rose onto it. It was the first time I'd been to a funeral, and I found it bleak and frightening. None of the ceremony reminded me about the fun, laughter and colourful times we'd had with Granny. It felt wrong somehow. Afterwards, we went back to the house for a do put on by the co-op funeral service. Granny had always been into good send-offs, and she reckoned the co-op did the best ones. Her friends and neighbours all came to the tea. The next day, I was back in school, my uncles went back to work, and Auntie Lizzie carried on cleaning the brasses. But sadness had settled over the house. Even so, every Sunday after Granny passed, Auntie Lizzie would put the roast on as Granny had, and then she and I would walk to the cemetery to put fresh flowers on my grandparents' graves, just as I would do years later for my own girls, Sarah and Vicky. One of the things that became a huge help and healer for me after Grandma passed was a little golden Labrador puppy that Uncle Tommy came home with one day to try to cheer us all up. She was a pedigree registered with the Kennel Club, and he'd done a deal in the pub with a local farmer. They gave her some fancy Kennel Club name like Salome Fascination, but you couldn't shout that out in the fields where we walked her, so we settled for Judy instead. Judy had recently left her mum when she came to live with us and was so nervous the poor little thing would shake all the time. So to make her feel more at home, we made her a cosy bed at the bottom of a warm cupboard in the back kitchen. But Judy still cried, so we tried her with a soft toy and a hot water bottle, but that didn't work either. Auntie Lizzie and Uncle Tommy told me to stop worrying, that she'd soon settle in. But I felt so sorry for her that I'd creep down in the middle of the night, scoop her up and take her back up to bed with me, where we'd cuddle up together and quickly drop off to sleep. I think we were a comfort to each other, and it was worth all the telling offs I got from Auntie and Uncle when they discovered she'd been in my bed again. By my early teens, my best friend Anne from school and I got into pop music and fashion. On Friday evenings and weekends, when there were no dance classes, I'd meet up with Anne and we'd play music at each other's houses or hang out at the local coffee bar and chat with some of the boys from the boys' brigade. I guess I did cause Auntie some concerns, but gradually laughter began to return to the house once again. Although my dad and uncles were still Borough supporters, by this time I was into Spurs and Manchester United, not least because, as regards the latter team, I had a thing about the gorgeous and talented George Best. One weekend, my friend Janet and her boyfriend Bernard came to stay at my house in Yarm. Bernard was from Liverpool, and when he found out I was a Manchester United supporter, he nearly choked. He gave me a look as if I was crazy. "You want to start supporting a decent team," he said in his Scouse accent. Although the conversation was just light-hearted banter, it is true to say that no matter how badly Borough performed, and by then we'd been relegated to the third division, my uncles were never fair-weather supporters and still went to their games. However, after speaking to Bernard, for some reason, I started looking out for Liverpool too. I suppose I was intrigued to see why he thought they were so great. But I think also it was because Liverpool had produced the biggest band on earth, the Beatles, whose music and films I'd grown up on and adored. Even though the Beatles had left Liverpool by this time, it still boasted the Mersey Sound, the Cavern Club, the Liverpool Poets, and the Liverbird sitcom was set there. It was a happening place that for a short while was rivaling the London scene. Unfortunately for me, I couldn't go to Liverpool, let alone see any of LFC's games. We lived too far away, and we couldn't afford a car. So instead, I would watch Liverpool FC play on Match of the Day, and later on ITV's The Big Match. It was at this time when the club was really taking off. The legendary Bill Shankly had brought them into the first division, and the following season, 1963-64, they won the league, followed by the FA Cup the season after when they played Leeds at Wembley, with Ian St John scoring the winner. Roger Hunt, who was top scorer for Liverpool 8 seasons in a row, was another great player at the club. As soon as he ran out onto the pitch, the fans would burst into a round of "Wonderful Roger" to the tune of the Wonderloaf advert that was on ITV at the time. Roger so delighted the fans that they dubbed him Sir Roger, although possibly the nearest he ever got to royalty and being knighted was playing Palace at Selhurst Park. It was the FA Cup of 1965 when Liverpool beat Leeds 2-1 that I really started to take notice. This would begin my lifelong love for Liverpool, the city, the football team and its people. Chapter 4. When I left school at 15, I began a 2-year course at the local tech college where I passed several O-levels. I was thankful to have had a decent head at my old school who'd suggested the college course because those qualifications set me in good stead, helping me to get a clerical job in Stockton when I left and later on when I was looking for a mortgage. I'd thrown in my dancing by this time and Auntie Lizzie, who was bitterly disappointed by this, having enjoyed watching me win my many medals, suddenly became aware of a craze that was sweeping the nation. Bingo! As dozens of local cinemas closed down every week, so new bingo halls opened in their place. How well I remember Auntie pulling on the box jacket that went with her pencil skirt, saying, "Well, I'll give it a go this Saturday, but don't hold your breath." She ended up going 4 nights a week, every week, for years, and she loved it. There would be a dance for teenagers in Yarm Village Hall every Saturday night with a rock and roll band playing, and I would go with my friends and meet boys there, including the local heartthrob, Derek. He looked so cool with his blonde hair and a quiff like Billy Fury. But with so many girls after him, I didn't think I stood a chance. So when he asked me out on a date, I thought all my Christmases had come at once, and by the following year we were engaged. If Sarah or Vicky had turned up years later, engaged at 17 to a Billy Fury lookalike, I would have been devastated. But Auntie Lizzie, Uncle Tommy and Derek's parents were all delighted. It wasn't long, though, before Derek bumped into an ex-girlfriend and dumped me for her. I was heartbroken, and there was nothing anyone could do or say to make me feel any better. After a few weeks of staying home feeling sorry for myself, my friend Linda from the travel agency where I worked persuaded me to go to a dance with her at the Astoria in Middlesbrough. My life would change forever when she introduced me to her ex-boyfriend that very first night. His name was Trevor. He was dark-haired, good-looking, and I fancied him straight away. The feeling must have been mutual, as the next day Trevor turned up on his motorbike at Linda's home. Linda's mum called to Linda, thinking he was there to take her out, but then he told her he'd come to see me. Once we began going out together, he'd turn up every evening on his motorbike when he wasn't studying at night school. Trevor lived 10 miles from me and was serving a mechanical engineering apprenticeship with ICI, which, when he finished it, was expected to lead to a secure job. Although Uncle Tommy always enjoyed a chat with Trevor whenever he came around, Auntie Lizzie did not take to him at all. And she didn't try to hide it. Fortunately, she was still going to bingo most nights. By this time, Uncle Stan and Lol had both got married and moved into their own homes. So whenever Uncle Tommy was at work and Auntie Lizzie was at bingo, Trevor and I had the house to ourselves. On Auntie's return, she'd say, "You've got work in the morning, our Jennifer. accompanied by loud yawning, to encourage Trevor to leave. She would never go to bed and leave us alone downstairs. Little did Auntie know that the very thing she worried about us getting up to had already happened while she was at the bingo hall, waiting for eyes down to be called. 6 months after we met, Trevor and I got engaged. We paid £25 each for an old Hillman Minx, which was maroon and cream, with cream leather upholstery inside. Instead of two separate front seats, it had one long front bench, which was great for cuddling up on when it was cold. And other things, too. Nobody in my family had ever owned a car before, and I felt really lucky. The following June, 6 months after the engagement, we got married at St. Mary Magdalene's Church, Yarm. I wore a long Empire Line dress made for me by Mrs. Etheridge, the lady who ran up the dresses for our dancing shows. It was so beautiful that when I went for the final fitting, I was really worried I wouldn't be able to afford it. However, Mrs. Etheridge wasn't having any of it. "You're not paying a penny. It's my wedding gift to you," she said. I was so touched by her kindness and relieved too, as we had so little money. By this time, I'd become used to adapting to my circumstances and being pragmatic, and with Trevor's help, we made the best of it. In fact, Trevor had managed to mould some fine wire into a tiara for me at his dad's garage and then set it with diamonds from an old necklace he'd taken apart. It looked fab and set off my auburn hair beautifully. Having had an unusual childhood, rather than follow the usual marriage traditions, I wanted Uncle Tommy to give me away. This caused an almighty row. "That's not right," Uncle Alfie protested. "It should be your dad." But because I'd grown up with Uncle Tommy, he felt more like a dad to me, and instinctively I thought he should be the one. We couldn't afford a honeymoon, so after a reception with a buffet in the Black Bull in Yarm, Trevor carried me over the threshold of our new home. This was a little flat we were renting in Stockton, while we tried to save every penny we could to scrape together enough for a deposit to buy our own home one day. With Trevor still earning peanuts as an apprentice and me able to earn more than him from the travel agent job, within a year we'd managed to make a deposit on our very first home. This was a new-build wimpy home at Thornaby near Stockton, south of the River Tees. It was nothing special by today's standards, but to me it was everything, and it symbolised how much I could achieve if I worked hard and put my mind to it, a lesson that stayed with me when I raised my girls, and later on when I faced my biggest challenge in life. My family were so proud to see I had got my own house too. People like us had only ever been able to afford to rent, and here were Trevor and I, at 21, with our own place. I only wish Granny and Grandad could have seen it. I know they'd have been pleased for me. I think my mum would have been made up too. Over the last few years, Mum and I had finally started to become closer, until tragedy struck, and once again someone I loved was taken away. Mum was only 54. Although she'd never really played a major role in my life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.